This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, told in the dormitory. Author, Reginald Gellibrand Jennings. Preface. When I have been on duty in the boarding house, I have told these stories to the boys in the dormitories. They have asked me to publish them, that they may read them for themselves. It is with their kind assurances that I send forth this book, not only to them, but to those hundreds of other boys whom I have the good fortune to know, and to those whom I do not know but wish I did. Topic: The Anarchist. The first year of this new century was not only a memorable one for Australia, but for the whole of the British nation. It was then, on a May morning, amid the shouts and cheers of a joyous multitude, that His Royal Highness the Duke of York opened the first Parliament of the Commonwealth of Australia. This great event naturally attracted immense crowds to the city of Melbourne, where the brilliant function took place. There were representatives of the great powers, well-wishers and sightseers, and there were others who had different motives for their presence in the city, and it is with these that we are chiefly concerned. It happened, one evening, as a certain Mr. Joseph Ballin was seated comfortably in an armchair in the smoking room of his club, enjoying an after-dinner cigar, that he noted the presence in the room of a stranger of a somewhat foreign appearance. Mr. Ballin was aware that at this time, Melbourne was particularly full of visitors, so he did not trouble to inquire into the identity of his companion, but buried his good-natured chubby face behind the pages of his evening paper. He formed a marked contrast to the stranger whose sharp foreign features and high forehead were fringed with dense black hair which stood upright. It was a cynical face, and by reason of its striking appearance of dejection, might have belonged to a man who had championed a lost cause, and probably not a good one. It was noticeable that he frequently cast nervous glances towards the door, as if he expected someone to enter. "Excuse me," he said at length, "but do you expect Mr. Childs tonight?" He spoke with a slightly halting accent, as if he were speaking a strange language, though he spoke it well. Mr. Ballin put down his paper and looked across at his companion. "Yes, my good sir, he was to meet me here at 8 o'clock. Do you happen to know him?" "No, no. At least, not exactly. You will pardon me, but is he not late?" Mr. Ballin pulled out his watch and glanced somewhat curiously at the foreigner. "Late? By Jove, yes. Never known him to be late before. Must have been detained. Important business in respect to the Duke, no doubt." He paused, and shook his glasses from his nose, and settled his bulky person in a comfortable position, which suggested that he intended to enter into a prolonged conversation with the foreigner. "Interesting man, this Mr. Childs, is he not?" he continued, addressing the stranger in quite a confidential manner. Nor did he seem to evince the least curiosity in regard to the presence of this strange individual who had so daringly and impertinently entered the clubhouse, without the privilege of membership, with the one object of gaining some information about this Mr. Childs, who, from his keen interest and frequent questions, seemed to interest him intensely. "Yes," went on Mr. Ballin, "an exceedingly interesting personality. A man with a history, I should say, a man who will make his mark. He is in Australia, I understand, for the purpose of shadowing His Royal Highness and generally protecting his person." As the foreigner sat there, he drank in every word that his unsuspecting informant uttered. Then he broke the silence himself with a question of such a quaint nature that even the slow-thinking Mr. Ballin was forced to wonder. "Has he a scar," he asked, "on the side of his neck?" Mr. Ballin, in fact, was so captivated by the uniqueness of this question and the intensity of interest with which it was asked, that he did not reply. The foreigner noticed his uneasiness and was quick to act. "You must excuse me," he went on in his halting way. "I see it is an embarrassing question. Please do not consider it. I hear the clock striking, and I fear I must leave you." With these abrupt words, he bowed with a peculiar, foreign gesture and then hurried from the room. Mr. Ballin put his cigar back into his mouth and blew a great cloud of smoke into the air and watched it slowly float towards the ceiling. I wonder if the man's mad, he thought. It is scarcely necessary to discuss the question as to whether the man was mad or not. But when a stranger enters a clubhouse without the privilege of membership, it either shows, as has already been suggested, a gross impertinence or, on the other hand, an audacious enterprise. There must obviously be some reason for such an unblushing intrusion, and it was for Karl Matres to decide whether his mission had proved successful. It is true he had not found the man he had hoped to meet, but he had obtained certain information which had helped to a great extent to solve a difficulty that had existed in his mind. His conversation with the chubby old gentleman in the armchair was not of itself of any grave importance, for he had learnt little from that source of this man whom people called Mr. Childs. The fact, however, that the famous detective had been absent from the club that evening helped to intensify this very unpleasant man's suspicions. He certainly had hoped to discover whether the detective had a scar on the side of his neck, which might seem to be of minor importance, though it would have satisfied Matres as to the identity of this one man of all others whose presence he so strongly dreaded. The scar had evidently been received on some previous occasion of which Matres had some knowledge. In the road outside the clubhouse, the electric lights exhibited, through the drizzling rain that was falling, a scene of confused disorder. Large skeletons of half-completed archways and various devices of decorative art marked the route along which, in a few days, His Royal Highness, the Duke of York, would proceed on his way to open this first parliament of the new Commonwealth. Surely this city would not be outdone in her tokens of loyalty and welcome. It was perhaps with good reason that Karl Matres, when he hurried from the clubhouse, avoided as far as possible the main thoroughfares. After pausing for a moment on the steps and glancing in both directions, he gathered the collar of his coat about his face and walked with a strange, uneven jerk until he came to a long, narrow street. It was a dark night, and thinking further precaution unnecessary or that it would give him an appearance of ease, he lit a cigarette. He made his way for some distance along the narrow street, which was little more than a lane, until he came to a dilapidated terrace. Here he halted before a door, and taking a large key from his pocket, he turned the lock and entered, closing the door behind him. A few moments later, a man came out from the shadow of a doorway on the opposite side of the street and walked slowly away. It would be as well to remark, perhaps, that he had a scar on the side of his neck. Now it is particularly noticeable, in tracing the great events of history, that they are in reality the outcome of some single individual's ideas. Sometimes it happens that these ideas are shallow and misguided, and are followed with that blind doggedness which ignorance and false ambitions engender. There are those who desire the equal distribution of wealth and the overthrow of authority, and societies are formed and campaigns organized for the purpose of carrying out these views. There exist, in various parts of the world, sections of malcontents who employ the foulest means to attain their ends. The business of these extremists or anarchists is a dangerous occupation indeed, and frequently ends in their own death, as well as that of the unfortunate object of their hatred. In fact, bomb throwing is a distinctly unpleasant hobby. No doubt Karl Matres had experienced the sensation, and as he sat up through the long night, poring over his plans of the city of Melbourne, he was tempted to speculate as to the possibilities of success. The undertaking demanded an indomitable courage, and yet he feared a single man who had followed him from Europe to Australia. He feared him more than he dreaded the danger of his mission. So the great May morning dawned. The long tiers of seats that lined the route were filled at an early hour with a dense, expectant throng. Eager faces gazed from windows and peered from rooftops. The arches and festoons were brilliant in their completeness. Indeed, such a lavish display, supported by genuine joyous enthusiasm, has seldom been surpassed in the history of the nations. For was not this the birthday of a new nation? The various officials and representatives, as they passed on their way to the exhibition buildings where the great ceremony was to take place, each received his share of welcome, for the heart of the people was one that day. There was no disorder. The dense mass waited in anxious expectancy, and those around the iron gates of the great building where the crowd was thickest gazed up at the dome and saw there floating gently in the faint breeze the flag of England, and they felt their hearts stir within them. Karl Matras, as he sought out a convenient place outside these gates, also looked up at the flag, and a cruel, desperate expression lit up his eyes. His thin, ferret-like face was pale and strained, and as he heard in the distance the growing cheers of the happy populace, he knew that the Governor-General's escort, which was to precede the royal procession by a few minutes, was approaching. The swaying of the crowd and waving of handkerchiefs, and the now deafening shouts, told that the popular young Governor-General was indeed being greeted with real enthusiasm. Nearer they approached the gates, till at length the outsiders came into view, followed by a body of mounted rangers who were in immediate advance of the postilions of the vice-regal carriage. The almost boyish face of the Governor-General smiled in response to the cheers which greeted him on all sides, and as he saluted with gracious dignity, it was easy, in spite of his smiles, to notice the drawn, worried expression of his handsome countenance. Suddenly the escort drew up. There was a block somewhere, and as the carriage came to a standstill immediately in front of Matras, the Governor-General leant forward and beckoned one of his equerries to him. It was whispered in some circles that the responsibility of the safety of the Duke was weighing heavily upon him. It was known that he had received several anonymous letters warning him of the presence in the city of men of suspected character, whose aim was the overthrow of royalty. The Governor-General gave some hurried instructions, and the equerry rode away to have them carried out, and in another few moments an order was shouted along the lines guarding the entrance to the grounds. With one accord they moved back 2 paces on each side, and thereby widened the roadway. Then the great gates were thrown open, and the strains of the national anthem announced the arrival of the first procession. The crowd now waited in anxious expectancy for the arrival of the royal party, and indeed the cheers could already be heard in the far distance. Of the tens of thousands that lined the streets that day, thousands had never seen a member of the royal family. They were now to greet in person the heir to their own throne in their island home, 12,000 miles away. Only a few months ago, they had received with mournful resignation the news of the death of their beloved Queen Victoria, whose name their state bore. They had heard, too, with the same feeling of concern, of the delayed coronation of King Edward VII, and the heir to the throne had not yet assumed the title of Prince of Wales. The expectancy increased as the cheers grew clearer, and Karl Matras experienced a sensation of cold uneasiness as he thrust his thin hand deep into his coat pocket to make sure that the concealed bomb was ready to do its infernal work. Nearer and clearer came the shouts and cheers, and the great crowd began to sway to and fro as each individual craned his neck to catch a first glimpse of the Duke who sat there in the foremost carriage, apparently unmoved, only recognizing with a slow, methodical movement the wild, spontaneous outburst of enthusiasm, while the Duchess, who was seated beside him, bowed in dignified response. The carriage was nearly opposite Matras. In another moment, it would reach the nearest point to him. His hands twitched nervously as he fingered the bomb. He had indeed been concerned in similar business before, but this meant death to him. He knew that, and his face was ghastly in its intensity of hidden purpose. Slowly his hand rose. In 1 second it would all be over, the wild cheers would be turned to groans. The hand was lifted from his pocket, the distance was calculated, he could feel himself swaying with the shouting throng. His hand rose a little higher, and then something firm had taken hold of his outstretched arm. He looked up and saw a face peering into his. It was to him the most dreaded face in all the world, and he heard even above the wild deafening cheers the calm clear voice of Mr. Childs, "A thousand pardons," it said. "I fear I have interrupted you." Then the gates were thrown open, and the strains of "God Save the King" floated like an answered prayer above the din. The gates swung back again, and their Royal Highnesses, the Duke and Duchess of York, passed on their way. When Matras had sufficiently recovered from his profound surprise, he looked around expecting to meet again the piercing eyes of his captor. But to his utter astonishment, the detective had disappeared. Such extraordinary conduct on the part of the man who had dogged his steps ever since he had come to Melbourne perplexed the anarchist considerably. Apparently, the little episode had passed unnoticed, and no one had even suspected his motive. He turned, and in dazed wonderment made his way hurriedly through the crowd until he reached a side street which led away from the dense multitude. On he went, scarcely daring to look round lest he might see the detective following him. But there was no fear of that. Mr. Child's extraordinary plan lay in quite another direction. It seemed almost beyond common reason to believe that he had allowed this dangerous anarchist to go free. Yet he had done so. The man had been in his very grasp, and now, to all intents and purposes, he was a free man. The detective had surely never had such an opportunity in his life of having his name on all lips and of making himself famous. Yet no one that day even so much as guessed what an awful calamity had been averted. No one could possibly have explained, if he had known, the detective's perplexing purpose. Yet late that night, when Mr. Childs returned to his room somewhat tired from the perpetual strain that had been so unconsciously laid upon him, he did not seek rest. He merely drew a big armchair up to the fire, and replacing his heavy coat with a dressing gown, he quietly lit a cigar and lay back in his chair. It is true, however, that his right hand did find its way to his vest pocket, where lay concealed a little revolver that might prove useful in an emergency. He drew it out, and in a leisurely fashion, brightened up the jeweled handle with a little piece of chamois, and then replaced it in his pocket with a genuine expression of pride, for it was the gift of a king. While engaged in this trivial occupation, it was easy to perceive that he was engrossed in thought. He suddenly rose from his seat, as if something had suggested itself to him, and going over to the sideboard, he lifted a decanter containing port wine and placed it on the table in the middle of the room. Beside it, he put two glasses, and then, standing beside the table in various attitudes, he endeavored to adjust it in such a way that the decanter and glasses were clearly reflected in the mirror of the sideboard. Having satisfied himself that the position was convenient for his purpose, he returned to his seat and in a few minutes appeared to be in a deep sleep. But a few minutes later he opened his eyes and sat up, then leaning over, he touched the electric bell at his side, and in a moment his manservant entered. He gave him some hurried instructions, and then looked up at the clock on the mantelpiece. It was nearly midnight. Just as the clock struck the hour, there was a ring of the doorbell, and the servant returned, announcing that a man wished to see him privately. The detective rose from his seat and instructed the servant to admit the visitor. So far, so good, he thought, as he awaited the entrance of the man. He cast a hurried look around the room to satisfy himself that all was in readiness. So far, so good, he repeated, as if his little plan had so far worked according to his desires, and there was apparently high hope of the plan continuing as he would wish it. It was like the spider and the fly business. He had lured his man into his den. His object, whatever it might be, would undoubtedly make itself clear very soon. The door at length opened, and Karl Matras entered. The fly came into the web. The detective bowed as if he were receiving a distinguished guest, and appeared to betray no surprise at this midnight visit, which he had so clearly expected. "Pray sit down," he said, motioning towards a chair. "I presume you do not object to smoking. May I offer you a cigar?" "No, I thank you. I do not desire to smoke. I prefer also that I stand. But may we proceed to business at once? Why did you not arrest me today? That is why I am here. I want to know." "Well, my friend, you have your answer in your own words. I did not arrest you, because I desired you to come here to inquire the reason." "But how did you know I would come?" "My good man, anarchists are, much as they might disguise it, merely human beings. At least, I believe so. It is my purpose to discover that tonight. Matras looked round the room, but did not reply. He noted the quiet taste with which everything was arranged, and the many photographs of celebrated men. In the corner he noticed a large engraving of the Duke, signed by himself. "I wanted you to come here tonight," the detective went on, "to talk to you as one man might talk to another. If there's one thing I admire in a man, it is pluck. You are an anarchist, but... then why did you save my life today? You admit I saved it? You saved a score of lives, including that cursed Duke of yours, who..." "Enough. Not a word about him. It is not your fault that he is not dead."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.